Hi,
my name is Derek Katz. I teach music history at UCSB, and I'd like to thank the Friends of the Goleta Valley Library for inviting me to speak to you. As people tend to say these days, I come to you from the past, so I hope things are well in the present as you watch this. So my talk is about the pianist, composer, and arranger Mary Lou Williams. And so perhaps the most obviously interesting thing about her from a historical perspective is that she made a brilliant career in all of those areas of music as a woman, as an African-American woman, at a time when that was even more difficult than it is today. An additional point, though, that she liked to stress herself was that she sort of played through all of the eras of jazz history. That is, her own development as a musician tracked the development of jazz itself as an art form. So what I would like to do is start by literally granting her a voice in the presentation. So here is the voice of Mary Lou Williams.
Hi, I am Mary Lou Williams. I have played through all the eras of jazz. The spirituals, ragtime, which my mother taught me when I was 3 years old. Then the time with John Williams, when the jazz bands was the name of any small group which played with a beat. And then the Kansas City swing era with Andy Kirk's band. Then bop, the Dizzy Gillespie era.
And I would like to take that little narration, which, by the way, comes from, as you probably saw from the slide, a 1970 LP that Mary Lou Williams recorded, preserving her own performances in different styles following the history of jazz. So I'd like to take those words as the structure for this presentation, taking us from Mary Lou Williams's childhood to, roughly speaking, the end of World War II, give or take. So, part one, childhood and musical beginnings, the spirituals, ragtime, that my mother taught me when I was 3 years old. So the artist that we now know as Mary Lou Williams was born somewhere in the area of 1910 as Mary Elfrida Scruggs. Both Lou and Williams came later. Her mother, indeed, played the piano or played keyboards, and apparently Mary Lou's first exposure to making music came from sitting in her mother's lap as her mother played the reed organ at a nearby storefront Baptist church. In a story that Mary Lou Williams loved to tell, when she was 3 or 4 years old, she was sitting in her mother's lap, her mother was playing, and the toddler Mary Lou reached up and started playing whatever it was that her mother had been playing back to her at the keyboard. Whether or not this actually happened in exactly that way, it certainly turned out to be the case that Mary Lou Williams had a phenomenal ear and a phenomenal musical memory, even by the standards of elite professional musicians. So her early music making took place at that very reed organ or harmonium, not in the family home, but in a church. Now, one of the problems is when you're 4 or 5 years old, you can't both reach the keyboard and have your feet touch the pedals to pump the organ. So a younger half-brother would kneel down on the ground and manually pump the organ while Mary Lou played. A certain amount of dedication on the part of the family. So she was born in Atlanta, but she grew up in Pittsburgh, where the family moved in 1915. And already, as a child, she picked up enough keyboard, enough piano, to play for local parties and social events and get paid for it. She's actually a significant contributor to the family income. The first really big break in her musical development comes when her stepfather buys her a player piano. So that is to say, a mechanical piano that can either be played conventionally using the fingers on the keyboard, or that can have rolls inserted to it and then can play pre-recorded music. So this is actually something that is quite common. Mary Lou Williams was far from the only famous jazz pianist to have learned quite a lot of music from the player piano. Duke Ellington would be another notable example. So you could learn multiple ways. You could learn by having the player piano just play the rolls, listen to them, and later imitate them. You could also adjust the speed on the player piano to slow it down to make it easier to hear what's going on, a technique that jazz musicians still use to learn solos. But also, you could sort of play along by putting your fingers on the keyboard and depressing the keys as the roll was being played. And again, that's how Duke Ellington did it, by actually physically feeling the keys go down, pressing them as they go down, then reproducing those same motions at the keyboard. She also, around the age of 12, moved in with an older sister. That's around the time of this picture, which is the earliest known picture of Mary Lou Williams. And that, when she moved into her older sister's household, that was around the time that the sister and her husband acquired a Victrola, an early record player. So that meant she could also listen to records. So the point I want to make here is that her early exposure to different styles of music largely came through mechanical reproduction. Records, 78 RPM shellac records, and piano rolls. So how was she was being at this point exposed to the leading players and styles of the time. She's listening to Jelly Roll Morton. She's listening to James P. Johnson. And in terms of style, what she's listening to, she refers to ragtime. She's specifically listening to the style of ragtime that we now call stride, which we associate with James P. Johnson or later Earl Hines. We'll listen to that in a second. She's listening to blues, she's listening to boogie-woogie, and so I want to emphasize the persistence of those styles in her career. Now, you will believe me when I tell you that there are no recordings of the 12-year-old Mary Lou Williams. So the first thing I'd like to play for you is actually a recording from 1930, but it's the first solo recording that she made, so it's going to have to do for our purposes. Just as a side note, almost all of the musical examples are taken from 78 RPM records that run about 3 minutes, 3.5 minutes at the most. I've tried to strike a balance between giving you a sense of what Mary Lou Williams' playing style sounds like and using up too much time with the examples. So the musical examples are mostly going to run somewhere around a minute plus minus, so just to be prepared. So as I say, this one, it's a Mary Lou Williams composition called Nightlife. She recorded it in Chicago in 1930 for Brunswick Records. It's her first solo record. And in general terms, this is a demonstration of the stride style or the ragtime style. So what you'll hear is, if you can hear and sort of split your hearing between the low and the high, the left hand and the right hand, the left hand is playing a very firm rhythm with low notes on, okay, for it's going to go 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4. So the left hand is playing low notes on 1, 3, 1, 3, and then higher chords on 2 and 4. So it's a band like umpat, basically a march accompaniment. The right hand is playing in a syncopated style. So here is Mary Lou Williams in the stride or ragtime style, Nightlife. One other quick musical example, so that was one style, ragtime or stride, and here is some boogie-woogie. So once again, it's a much, much later recording, but of a Mary Lou Williams boogie-woogie style composition that she included in that same history of jazz narration that we heard before. So here we go, Hesitation Boogie.
During this period, boogie-woogie was also very popular. I was never considered a top boogie-woogie pianist, but was trained to play all styles. Now I would like to play my Hesitation Boogie.
So what you may have noticed is what both of those pieces have in common is a very strong rhythmic and harmonic outline coming from the left hand. And this is actually something that at the time was gendered. Now, Mary Lou Williams didn't like being perceived as a woman musician. So here's a quote from her own words. "As for being a woman, I never thought about that one way or another. All I've ever thought about is music. My whole life was, and still is, just music." However, you know, her playing inevitably was perceived in the context of gender, and she also wrote about that. So again, Mary Lou Williams' words again, quote, "They say I play like a man. That influence came early. I gained my first fame playing strong, hard, swinging, left-handed rag piano," end quote. So just a little note, and everything you're going to hear from her, you're going to hear that strong left hand, either in a stride style or a boogie-woogie style. And so that's, again, that not only was fitting in with the jazz aesthetic of the time, but was also a way of asserting herself as just a musician rather than as a hyphenated female musician. Okay, step two, her early professional career. Then the time with John Williams, when the jazz bands was the name of any small group that played with a beat. So, as I mentioned, she was already being paid to play, sometimes with professionals, as a child. And by the age of 14, as a high schooler, she joined a professional touring vaudeville show. This professional show was led by a dancer named Buzzin Harris, and the show was called Buzzin Harris and His Hits and Bits. And there is Mary Lou in the lower right-hand corner. So this was a variety show, an act on a variety show that traveled through the Theater Owners Booking Association, or as was inevitably referred to by African-American performers, the Tough on Black, You Can Fill in the Rest circuit. On this circuit, they played mostly in Pennsylvania and Ohio. They made it to Chicago in 1925. And so this is not only provides Mary Lou Williams a professional opportunity, it also brings her in contact with other musicians. So she's starting more and more to hear the musicians that she'd first heard on the player piano, on the Victrola, live in person, and to meet them and work with them. So there's one notable example in 1926, where she attends a rehearsal of a show being directed by Fats Waller. She then proceeds to play back for Fats Waller from memory every single song from that show. So again, the phenomenal musical memory, the phenomenal ear, prominent throughout her career. So this particular show with Buzzin Harris, obviously it's an important story for her professional development, but it's also an important story for her personal life. During this show, she also meets a saxophonist named John Harris. Here you see him with both his alto and his baritone saxophone, and he would be her first husband, so hence the years with John Williams. Here's a picture of Williams on his own with the alto sax. So he became the leader of the band for Hits and Bits. He was about 5 years older, given that we don't know exactly when Mary Lou Williams was born. All dates are approximate, but you know, somewhat older. In addition to Hits and Bits, Mary Lou Williams also plays in the band that accompanies another vaudeville act, the dancers Seymour and Jeanette, with their band, the Syncopators. The next big event in what will turn out to be the big event in Mary Lou's life is that in 1928, John Williams, her husband, the saxophonist, packs up and moves to Oklahoma City to join a band called the Dark Clouds of Joy, and Mary Lou follows him to Oklahoma City. And so this brings us to part three, in which Mary Lou Williams' professional life intersects with the history of the jazz recording industry. And then the Kansas City Swing era with Andy Kirk's band. Who, you might wonder, is Andy Kirk? Well, you heard about the Dark Clouds of Joy. In early 1929, not long after John Williams joined the band, the Dark Clouds of Joy fired their leader. They were a collective, which is actually interesting. And they reorganized under a musician named Andy Kirk, whom you see pictured here. And it is with Andy Kirk and the reorganized 12 Clouds of Joy that Mary Lou Williams would become a nationally and internationally known musician. Andy Kirk was from Denver. He played low instruments, primarily the brass bass or sousaphone, although he's also on record as playing bass saxophone and string bass. He was trained not so much as a jazz musician as a dance musician, which is important later on. And it's also important to think a little bit about what being the leader meant. So he wasn't doing a lot to contribute directly to the sound of the organization. As far as the recording history goes, he's only heard as a sousaphonist or bass saxophonist in the first few records. For most of the life of the band, he does nothing audible on the recordings. He was responsible for organizational things. He booked the band into different venues. He decided what they were going to play. He hired and fired musicians, again, working with the group as a collective. And he also did some arranging. So he was the leader, but he wasn't really the voice of the ensemble, as it were. So there was room for other musicians, one of them, of course, being Mary Lou Williams, to fill that role. Okay, so we've got John Williams in this group. We've got it reorganized under Andy Kirk. It's now called the 12 Clouds of Joy, and it moves to Kansas City in 1929. And Mary Lou Williams follows the band again, this time to Kansas City. And while she's in Kansas City, she's immersed in the particular styles of jazz that are particularly important and prevalent in Kansas City. So that's especially what we might think of as boogie-woogie or barrelhouse piano. Now, at this point, she's playing in Kansas City. She's going to jam sessions in Kansas City. But she's a band wife. She's not actually playing in the Andy Kirk band. She is not one of the 12 Clouds of Joy. And this doesn't actually reflect sexism. It's just that the band already had a perfectly adequate pianist. However, she was, again, a very good musician. She was hanging around the band. She does some work for the band. She creates solos for the band members that didn't improvise. She begins to suggest musical ideas to Andy Kirk and to do some arranging. This picture is about 10 years too late, but it just, you see the two of them, the idea of Mary Lou Williams and Andy Kirk collaborating is what I want to emphasize here. And so the fact that, So as I say, although she's not a member of the band, she does play with them sometimes. She fills in if the regular pianist can't make a gig. They go through a period where they use two pianos, or they're using both pianists at the same time. But her big break with respect to the band actually comes courtesy of the recording industry. So the intersection between the 12 Clouds of Joy and the recording industry happens when a company, representatives of a company called Brunswick Records, comes to Kansas City in 1929 looking for an African-American jazz band to record. As it happens, when the band is slated to audition for Brunswick Records, the regular pianist doesn't show up. Apparently, I think he was in a car accident on the way to the gig. But in any case, they need a pianist. John Williams says, "Hey, how about Mary Lou?" So Mary Lou comes in. She knows the band's repertoire. She plays the audition. Then, when it comes time, the audition goes well. Brunswick hires them to make recordings, and Andy Kirk, being a decent guy, says, "Well, okay, Mary Lou, you played the audition, you play the records." So the first recordings of the 12 Clouds of Joy, made for Brunswick Records in 1929, do in fact feature Mary Lou Williams at the piano. So, all well and good. These recordings, however, raise at least two, I think, interesting and important issues. The first is that these records are a commercial product aimed at a particular market. They're not documentation of the band's activities. So, what we have on record is what Brunswick Record thought they could sell, not what Andy Kirk and his 12 Clouds of Joy were doing in dance halls and ballrooms in Kansas City. So these are two very different things. Andy Kirk was a dance musician. In his own words, "We emphasize dance music, romantic ballads and pop tunes and waltzes. Viennese as well as standard popular waltzes like Kiss Me Again and Alice Blue Gown. I love to play waltzes. We were first and last a dance orchestra because people were dancing. So in Kansas City, Andy Kirk and his 12 Clouds of Joy were primarily playing for white dancers at the Playmore Ballroom, although they did play for African-American audiences as well. But they weren't playing what we would think of as jazz. They were playing, as you'd gather, dance music, foxtrots, waltzes, one-steps, two-steps, ballads, exactly what Andy Kirk just said they were doing. They did play a little bit of what we would think of as hot jazz, but that wasn't dance music. There were sort of intermission features. In between sets, sometimes they would play some jazz to sort of, get the dancing crowd excited. But that wasn't their bread and butter as a performing, working band. So that's what the Andy Kirk band was doing, but that's not what Brunswick Records wanted. Brunswick Records wanted to make what we would now call, or actually what they called at the time, race records. That is, records made by African Americans, specifically to be sold to African Americans. So the obvious point here is that you have a record company run by white executives and business people telling African American musicians what they ought to play to meet the demands of a partially notional African-American audience. So the records that we have do not really reflect what Andy Kirk wanted, or they reflect what the Brunswick executives wanted. So the other interesting point here is that this split between, on the one hand, the waltzes and romantic ballads and foxtrots that Andy Kirk wanted to play and did play in his ballroom life, and hot jazz on the other, that split was assumed to map along racial lines. That is, the type of music that Andy Kirk was playing on an everyday basis was seen as white music. And as a matter of fact, there's a whole collection of stories either linking Andy Kirk to famous white musicians or about people perceiving the band as white when they heard them on records or on the radio. So Mary Lou Williams, for instance, described Andy Kirk as wanting to be, quote, the black Guy Lombardo, Guy Lombardo being probably the leading name to conjure with for sweet saxophone vibrato-laden, high-polished, sweet dance music. And just for one of these anecdotes now from her husband, John Williams, who said in an interview, quote, when we played the Apollo in Harlem for the first time, the chorus girls were so surprised we were black. So that is, people had heard them on the radio, had heard them on records, and assumed they were a white band based on the musical style. What's interesting for the third thing that might be interesting from our purposes is that the desires of the recording executives aligned very neatly with Mary Lou Williams's own musical intentions and desires. So that is to say that it was exactly the things that Mary Lou Williams brought to the musical table. Stride, boogie woogie, blues, those things were exactly what the recording executives wanted. They wanted, if you look at the record label here, pieces called stomp. That was a stomp was a kind of dance. That was the word to conjure with at the time. They wanted African-American bluesy lowdown stomps, and that was exactly what Mary Lou Williams could give them. So because of this overlap between what Mary Lou Williams did and what the recording executives wanted, she becomes the central figure. She not only joins the Andy Kirk band regularly, she is now finally herself a cloud of joy, but she becomes the voice of the ensemble, both as the leading soloist at the piano and as a composer and arranger. This is a little tacky, but to give you a sense of her centrality, here's a picture of her, of the band, with her all the way in the back. Here's another picture of the band with her right in the center. Anyway, you get the idea. So one of the things I wanted to point out about the arranging is one of the things that happens during these years is that Mary Lou Williams, who learned all of her music by ear, needs to learn how to read music and write it. So she goes from being somebody who feels very strongly that it's very, very important to learn things by ear and only by ear, to picking up the skill of writing, notating, arranging music because she so wants to be a composer and arranger. So it's a very interesting career shift, I think, from that point of view. Here is one of those early recordings from that first recording session in 1929. It's called Froggy Bottom. And so this features Mary Lou Williams, you know, in a certain sense, in all of her capacities. It's a blues. It doesn't actually have a whole lot of arranging. We're only going to hear the beginning. There is an ensemble blues chorus a little later on, but we're not going to hear it. But you'll hear Mary Lou herself playing the piano, so you'll hear her featured as soloist. You'll hear the first solo blues chorus from one of the other instrumentalists. So there's not a whole lot of arranging going on, but everything that you hear is her responsibility. It's her tune, her piano solo, her arranging. So here is Andy Kirk and his 12 Clouds of Joy featuring Mary Lou Williams playing Froggy Bottom. Okay, so this brings us now to the next section of the presentation, a little more about the recording industry, taking us to the end of Mary Lou Williams's collaboration with Andy Kirk. There is a hole in recording history in general of the jazz world, or a great decline in the recordings of hot jazz around the beginning of the Depression. So not at all surprisingly, Andy Kirk and the 12 Clouds of Joy don't make records in between 1931 and 1936. So the next documentation that we have of Mary Lou Williams with the group comes from a second set of recordings made in 1936. This picture of the band is from somewhere around that time, 1936 or 1937. So one of the big changes between 1931 and 1936 is that now swing is the style to be heard and the word, I'm going to use the phrase word to conjure with, for the third time. So they used to be a stomp band, now they're a swing band, and Mary Lou Williams is not only the featured soloist and most important member of the band, but she is explicitly called the lady who swings the band. And we know this because there's a song about her, which I think we absolutely need to hear. So she didn't write the song, she didn't write the words, she didn't write the music, but she did do the arranging. So this gives us a couple reasons to listen to it. The first is, of course, it's a song about her. Isn't that wonderful? And she's playing the piano. But also, this gives us a much better sense of what she was doing as an arranger. Unlike Froggy Bottom from 1929, by 1936, there's a lot of ensemble arranging going on. It's really very precisely and deftly orchestrated. So listen to what's going on with the horn writing in the band, as well as listening to her piano playing, and the, I think, reasonably charming lyrics. And also, when she comes in and plays, you know, listen to that strong left hand again. We still got that stride left hand going as she's swinging the band. All right, here we go.
Kansas City, there's a pretty gal named Mary Lou, and she plays the piano in a manner that is all too new. Here of late she's playing with a band. Let me tell you of this baby and the baby grand. When you hear a hot jumbo, who's the power behind the mold? It's the lady who swings the band. When you hear the saxes ride, who's the reason why they glide? It's the lady who swings the band. When the rhythm section gives you action, the lady at the keys is the main attraction, who makes dancers on the floor beat their feet and yell for more. It's the lady who swings the band.
There she is, Mary Lou Williams, swinging the band. So, you know, at this level, already, you know, continuing in 1936, we still see this overlap between the styles in which Mary Lou Williams was proficient and what the recording executives wanted. But at the same time, Andy Kirk is still pushing to do what he thinks of as his music. In particular, he really wants to do what we would now think of as sort of pop ballads. And he finally, around this time, talks the now Decca jazz folks into putting on the flip side of a jazz tune one of the ballads that he wants to do. And so this is a ballad that features a sort of a guy with a lovely voice, a crooning tenor named Fay Terrell. And the ballad in question is Until the Real Thing Comes Along. And so let's just listen to the first vocal chorus of Until the Real Thing Comes Along, which I misspelled on the slide. Sorry about that. Anyway, you'll hear the word sung correctly, and you'll just get the sense that this is a very different kind of music than what we've heard from the 12 Clouds of Joy up until now. So, Fay Terrell.
I would work for you, I'd slave for you, I'd be a beggar or a knave for you. If that ain't love, it'll have to do. Until the real thing comes along, I'd gladly move the earth for you, to prove my love, dear, and its worth for you. If that ain't love, it'll have to do. Until the real thing comes along, with all the words, dear, at my command, I just can't make you understand. I'll always love you, darling, come what may. My heart is yours, what more can I say? I'd beg for you, I'd lie for you, I'd draw the stars down from the sky for you. If that ain't love, it'll have to do. Until the real thing comes along.
So as it happens, Kirk's pushiness is greatly rewarded. This particular record becomes one of the great hits of the swing era. We don't have exact sale figures. According to Kirk, he went from selling tens of thousands of records to selling hundreds of thousands of records. Not surprisingly, Decca knows a good thing when they hear it, and they become much more interested in recording more romantic ballads featuring Fay Terrell. They become less interested in the kind of jazz-based recordings that featured Mary Lou Williams. So I don't want to make it sound as if Mary Lou Williams is immediately absent from the band sound, but she's de-emphasized. She's now sort of one of the possible flavors that's marketable for the 12 Clouds of Joy. So, you know, just to show that they continue to do things that were in her bag, just one more example of I guess this is going to be the last example of Mary Lou Williams with the 12 Clouds of Joy, or as one of the 12 Clouds of Joy. So here's a song that she wrote. She wrote the music, not the lyrics, called Little Joe from Chicago, about Joe Glazer, who is the manager of the band, as well as Louis Armstrong's manager. And this, again, it's blues changes. It's a boogie-woogie style, because we got the boogie-woogie left hand. So you'll hear the part with Mary Lou playing the piano and just the very, very beginning of the vocal chorus. So, Little Joe from Chicago. So although, as I say, Decca does continue to record some numbers that feature Mary Lou Williams as a composer, as a pianist, increasingly her role in the band is minimized, while that of Faye Terrell and eventually other vocalists and soloists becomes more prominent. So I have no idea what was going on in this actual picture, but here we have a picture from around this time of Andy Kirk on the left looking quite satisfied, Mary Lou Williams in the middle looking quite grumpy, and Faye Terrell to our right looking quite happy indeed. So that we don't know if that actually represents the priorities of the group, but it can stand for it. So during these later years, Mary Lou Williams becomes increasingly alienated from Andy Kirk, and she eventually leaves the band in 1942. And this brings us to the final section, what happened more or less after the swing era, or at least after her participation in the 12 Clouds of Joy. So I'm going to cheat a little bit. What Mary Lou Williams emphasizes in her narration is the bebop era. That's the end of her little narration. Then bop, the Dizzy Gillespie era. And that does form part of Mary Lou Williams' story in the early 1940s. Here we see her in 1944 at home in New York. She becomes a mentor to that younger generation of bebop musicians, including Dizzy Gillespie, here seen in the left of the picture, a couple other important bebop musicians, Tad Dameron and Hank Jones, moving from our left to the right. So, and she plays and records bebop with a number of musicians as well. But perhaps more importantly for us, she is now free to pursue multiple careers and professional outlets. So one of the things that she does is to continue to sell arrangements to other band leaders. That is, she's writing down music for swing era ensembles, but then selling those arrangements, those compositions, to be played and recorded by other people. So she's not physically present on stage, she's not playing the piano, but her music is being heard. So she's arranging for Benny Goodman, she's arranging for Duke Ellington, she's arranging for Louis Armstrong. So that is to say, she is writing for the most important and famous musicians, both white and African American, in styles, you know, in a range of styles from swing and beyond. So the whole question of arranging is an interesting one. In a certain sense, the fact that she's collaborating with these very, very prominent musicians is fabulous from the point of view of professional development. On the other hand, first off, she's not making a lot of money doing this. She gets a lump sum. But also, the role of the arranger is almost completely invisible. If you were to go to dance to Benny Goodman or to hear Duke Ellington in concert, you would not know necessarily who the composer of a tune was, and you almost certainly wouldn't know who arranged it. You know, maybe if you buy a record, the names of the composer and lyricist would be on the record, but probably not the arranger. So this is a way in which Mary Lou's voice was heard, but it was not acknowledged or known by many people that were hearing it. So I'd also just like to give a little sense of, you know, what it means to arrange a composition. So let's take 2 minutes to hear first a boogie-woogie style composition by Mary Lou Williams called Roll 'Em. So again, it's a very familiar style for us. Let's hear it first, right period of time for us, 1944, played by Mary Lou Williams with a small ensemble featuring Frankie Newton, Vic Dickerson, and Edmund Hall on trumpet, trombone, and clarinet. So what we're going to hear is first an arranged introduction, which features the horns, and then a piano solo featuring Mary Lou Williams, her piano, her composition, again with that strong boogie-woogie left hand. So let's hear the small ensemble version of Roll 'Em. Here is the same composition in the arrangement that Mary Lou Williams did for Benny Goodman. And so you immediately hear Goodman plays it a lot faster. In this arrangement, the introduction is shorter. And when we get to the part that corresponds to the Mary Lou Williams piano solo, that strong boogie-woogie bass line, which used to be the left hand of the piano, has been moved into the saxophone section. Roll 'Em, played by Benny Goodman and his orchestra. You heard a little bit of Jess Stacy at the piano towards the end of that track. So obviously, you know, you're looking at the picture, you're seeing an all-white swing band playing a composition, an arrangement by an African-American woman. Benny Goodman was, in fact, a pioneer in integrating swing, bringing Lionel Hampton and Teddy Wilson into his trio and sextet, later Charlie Christian on the electric guitar, and eventually, to at least a certain extent, integrating the larger band as well. In terms of the gender and racial politics of the swing era, although there was some movement towards integration and creating mixed swing bands, bands were much, much slower to admit women. So the fact that we don't see Mary Lou Williams in this picture, to a certain extent, the fact that she if she were in the picture, it would be more remarkable to see a woman than it would be to see an African American, which is, I think, something interesting to think about. All right, just a couple of other things. When she's not providing arrangements to other famous people, her big source of income is a regular gig at a cabaret called Café Society in New York. She had a regular gig there playing mostly with a piano trio. This is a place that's interesting in a number of levels. One is it was a place where largely African-American musicians were playing for racially mixed audiences. But again, this is a big shift. She's no longer traveling with a band. She's now resident in New York, playing every night as a featured soloist with a trio with bass and drums. She also, during 1945, has a weekly half-hour-long radio station, the Mary Lou Williams Piano Workshop, on station WNEW. And then the last thing I want to highlight is another direction for her music that was inspired by Duke Ellington. And in particular, it was inspired by a concert that Duke Ellington gave at Carnegie Hall in January of 1943. So Mary Lou Williams was connected to this concert in multiple ways. One was, again, a personal connection. She was now married to one of the trumpet players in the Duke Ellington Orchestra, Harold Shorty Baker, a picture from 1946. And so once again, during this brief period, Mary Lou Williams was a band wife, and she was traveling with the Ellington Orchestra. She was providing arrangements and compositions. She was hearing the band on a regular basis. And in fact, the documentation's a little unclear, but she appears to have provided two of the arrangements that were heard at that very Carnegie Hall concert, both of those arrangements featuring big solos for Shorty Baker, not at all surprisingly. But the really important thing of that concert was that it was in this Carnegie Hall concert in 1943 that Duke Ellington presented for the first time a 45-minute extended composition for his orchestra called Black, Brown, and Beige, which he frequently referred to, you see here on the RCA Victor record jacket, as a tone parallel to the American Negro. It's also been described as a tone poem, as a jazz symphony, but it's a long, multi-movement composition that mixes various jazz styles with other styles. So this is a type of moving the jazz style, moving the jazz band into the physical space devoted to concert music, Carnegie Hall, and assuming some of the aspirations of concert music, both in the sense of the aspirations to length, something that's 3/4 of an hour long instead of 3.5 minutes long, but also that needs to be listened to. This is not dance music, it's not functional music, it's really concert music. So Mary Lou Williams is there at the concert, and not long after that, she begins creating what she would call her Zodiac Suite. This is, again, an extended work somewhere in the 45-minute range that shows a combination of jazz styles with other styles. This is a period when Mary Lou Williams is becoming very interested in 20th century European art music. Now, again, this is somebody who grew up on the blues, on boogie-woogie, on ragtime, who believed that to read music was to kill your musical inspiration. Now she's listening to and studying Bartok and Debussy and Ravel and Hindemith and Schoenberg. Big change in her musical life. So the Zodiac Suite starts off as at least partially improvised piano solos that she plays movement by movement, week by week, for her radio show, for WNEW. She does record the entire suite, partially as piano solos, partially for trio with bass and drums. But I think most interestingly for our purposes, she follows Duke Ellington's lead and presents it as a large ensemble composition in a concert setting. So this concert setting is in another prominent New York concert hall, New York's Town Hall, and she presents it in a chamber orchestra version that includes strings. So the orchestration is done in collaboration with a guy named Milt Orent. You see him in the left-hand side of the picture here with Mary Lou Williams, Hank Jones at the piano, Dizzy Gillespie in the background, beboppers again. So Milt is a classically trained bass player. He's a staff arranger for NBC. He helps Mary Lou Williams to turn the Zodiac Suite into a piece that can be played by a chamber orchestra, and he conducts the town hall concert. So in a moment, but not right away, I want to listen to the Aquarius, or have us listen to the Aquarius movement from the Zodiac Suite as recorded live at that very big band concert in Town Hall in New York. But before I do that, I want to sort of wrap things up and just point out that, so I'm taking you to 1945. I've been going on for a long time. I don't want to tax your patience any longer than I already have. Obviously, 1945 is not the end of Mary Lou Williams's career. It is the end of that narration, the end of the tidy overlap between her musical development and the history of jazz, but there's a lot of stuff that I'm not going to tell you about. After World War II, she retreats from public performance for a few years. She establishes a career in Europe with a long residency at a cafe in Paris. She has a conversion to Catholicism. She's a pioneer in writing liturgical music for the Catholic Church that includes jazz and blues styles. She becomes an important educator. Her last position is at Duke University. But I'm not going to tell you about any of that stuff. I'm just hinting that it's out there. So what I'd like to do is, first off, thank you for your attendance and patience. I come to you from the past, but I am happy to feel that I'm sharing this with you in the present. And having thanked you, I'll now drop the virtual needle on Aquarius, at least at the time that I think this the video link is going to be dropped, will be the appropriate zodiac sign. This particular movement was dedicated to FDR, which you may or may not feel is appropriate, and it's also my sign. So those are the reasons. And the most important reason is this movement also features a big bassoon solo, and that's my instrument. So there you have all of my selfish motives. So I will now allow you to listen to Aquarius from the Zodiac Suite. It takes about 2 minutes and 40 seconds, and I will just stop talking, start the music playing, and that'll be the end of the presentation. Feel free to stick around for the entire movement, or not, completely up to you. Thank you again.